You know, there's some Christians who have a Christian life that stinks. It's full of maggots. You know why? You're trying to live tomorrow or today on yesterday's supply.
Put your hand in the hand of the man who stilled the water. Put your hand in the hand of the man who calmed the sea. And take a look at yourself, and you can look at others differently by putting your hand in the hand of the man from Galilee. Every time I look into the holy book, I want to tremble. When I read about the part where a carpenter cleared the temple, yeah. Well, the buyers and the sellers were no different fellas than what I profess to be. And it causes me shame to know we're not the people we should be. Put your hand in the hand of the man who stilled the water. Put your
You have your Bible with you. I'm going to read from the book of Exodus, the second book of the Old Testament, and chapter 16. If you've been with us some previous weeks, we have been looking into these early chapters of the book of Exodus. This will be the last occasion for a while because of other events coming up. But I want to read to you an important section of this chapter, which follows immediately on the part we looked at last week, where the Israelites came to a place called Marah, where the water was bitter. And then God took them through to a place called Elim. And then chapter 16 and verse 1 says, the whole Israelite community set out from Elim and came to the desert of Sin, which is between Elim and Sinai. On the 15th day of the second month after they had come out of Egypt. In the desert, the whole community grumbled against Moses and Aaron. The Israelites said to them, if only we had died by the Lord's hand in Egypt. There we sat around pots of meat and ate all the food we wanted. But you have brought us out into this desert to starve this entire assembly to death. Then the Lord said to Moses, I will rain down bread from heaven for you. The people are to go out each day and gather enough for that day. In this way, I will test them and see whether they will follow my instructions. On the sixth day, they are to prepare what they bring in, and that is to be twice as much as they gather on the other days. So Moses and Aaron said to all the Israelites, in the evening, you will know that it was the Lord who brought you out of Egypt. In the morning, you will see the glory of the Lord because he has heard your grumbling against him. Who are we that we should grumble against us? Moses also said, you will know that it was the Lord when he gives you meat to eat in the evening and all the bread you want in the morning because he has heard your grumbling against him. Who are we? You're not grumbling against us, but against the Lord. Verse 11, the Lord said to Moses, I have heard the grumbling of the Israelites. Tell them at twilight you'll eat meat, and in the morning you will be filled with bread. Then you'll know that I am the Lord your God. That evening, quail came and covered the camp. And in the morning, there was a layer of dew around the camp. When the dew was gone, thin flakes like frost on the ground appeared on the desert floor. When the Israelites saw it, they said to each other, what is it? They did not know what it was. Moses said to them, it is the bread the Lord has given you to eat. This is what the Lord has commanded. Each one is to gather as much as he needs. Take an omer for each person you have in your tent. The Israelites did as they were told. Some gathered much, some little. And when they measured it by the omer, he who gathered much did not have too much, and he who gathered little did not have too little. Each one gathered as much as he needed. Then Moses said to them, no one is to keep any of it until morning. However, some of them paid no attention to Moses. They kept part of it until morning, but it was full of maggots and began to smell. So Moses was angry with them. Keep your Bible open. I'm going to refer back to some of those verses. And we're looking at this story of the Israelites and their journey out of Egypt. Not because we're merely interested with a little bit of Old Testament history, but because this journey is retold many times in the Scriptures as a parallel of Christian experience. The deliverance from Egypt is a picture of deliverance from sin. The Passover, which was the final straw which broke the back of Pharaoh, is a foreshadowing of Christ, our Passover, who was sacrificed for us, as Paul describes it. And the purpose was to take them into the land of Canaan, a land flowing with milk and honey, that in the book of Hebrews represents the fullness of life that God intends Christian people to enjoy. And we come to an event here where God miraculously provides the people with manna. It was a wafer-like thing in appearance. It was to feed them sufficiently to keep them alive. And there's some very important truths that come out of this provision of manna. They were 6 weeks into the journey when God began to provide them with manna, because it describes it in verse 2 as being on the 15th day of the second month after they'd left Egypt. And they have started to grumble there in verse 2. In fact, if you go through this chapter, you'll find that 7 times in chapter 16, the people grumble and are grumbling. And there was good reason for this. The journey from Egypt to Canaan should have been completed by now, because Deuteronomy chapter 1 and verse 2 tells us there that it is an 11-day journey from Horeb, which is where God spoke to Moses at the burning bush, an 11-day journey from Horeb to Kadesh Barnea by the Mount Seir road. Now, Kadesh Barnea was the town in southern Canaan, or right on the border, where when they did eventually get there after 2 years, God said, now enter the land, although they didn't, because they were scared of the inhabitants of the land. And so had they gone the direct route at the fastest pace that was possible to them, it is described as an 11-day journey. It's not actually that far. It's less than 500 kilometers. It's less than the distance between Toronto and Montreal. And it was a journey which took them 40 years altogether. And I have worked out, if my arithmetic is correct, that they averaged about 36 meters a day, 250 meters a week. Something has gone wrong. And my purpose this morning is not to talk about those main issues that have gone wrong. We find them repeated, though we find them crystallized, especially in Numbers chapter 13 and 14. If you read those two chapters sometime, when they sent spies into Canaan who came back, most of them with their tails between their legs, saying it's totally impossible that we can go into this land because they're bigger than we are. They live in fortified cities. They're trained in warfare. We are not. There's many more of them. We felt like grasshoppers in comparison to them. And they brought all this grumbling, mumbling, complaining. At least 10 of the 12 spies did. And 2 of them, Joshua and Caleb, said, yes, but God is going to give us the land. But they were outvoted and the people turned south. So the reason why they didn't go into Canaan is because of fear and lack of trust. Something has gone wrong. But the point I do want to talk to you about this morning is that here in chapter 16, after they were designed to have been in the land time-wise, God feeds them with something called manna. And there are two aspects I want to talk about this morning. There's something right about this provision of manna. And secondly, there's something wrong about this provision of manna. What's right about this provision of manna is that God provides them every morning with a fresh supply of bread that will sustain them during the day. We just read they were to go out every morning, 5 days a week, and they were to get enough on those 5 days to last them only for the day, because there'd be a fresh supply the next day. On the 6th day, they were to gather enough to last them for 2 days, because on the 7th day, there'd be no provision of manna. And in the New Testament, when Jesus engaged the Jews in conversation on one occasion in John chapter 6, they said to Jesus, Moses gave us food in the wilderness. And Jesus corrected them. He said, I tell you the truth, this is John 6 verse 32, it was not Moses who has given you the bread from heaven, but it was my Father who gives you, present tense now, gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. Sir, they said, from now on, give us this bread. And Jesus declared, I am the bread of life. And so Jesus in John 6 tells the Jews that this provision of bread, this provision of manna every morning is in some way, and a very important way, a picture of himself. And I think the beautiful picture about this is the picture of the freshness of the supply every day. You see, you and I are not invited to live on stale relationships with Jesus Christ. We are intended to live on the basis of a fresh daily supply of life and strength and nourishment. As the book of Lamentations says, Lamentations 3:22, because of the Lord's great love, we're not consumed. His compassions never fail. They are new every morning. But there are some Israelites in this group who didn't like the idea of going out every day for 6 days. And so on the first day, they decided to take enough home for tomorrow, and they took some of the manna and they tucked it away in the back of their tents. And next morning, everybody got up to go out and get the fresh supply of manna. They stayed in bed and then went to dig out yesterday's manna to eat it for breakfast. And it says it was full of maggots and it stank. You know, there's some Christians who have a Christian life that stinks. It's full of maggots. You know why? You're trying to live tomorrow or today on yesterday's supply. You know, if you come to church on Sunday hoping this will somehow recharge your battery and pump you up enough to last the next 6 days, your spiritual life will stink by Tuesday, if not by Monday. It won't work. His mercies are new every morning. And this, in this sense, is a very beautiful picture of the fact that God gives us today what we need today. He gives us tomorrow what we need tomorrow. He doesn't give us today what we need tomorrow. I remember in Glasgow, being in Glasgow in Scotland on one occasion, when a man came to talk to me. I'd been speaking at a week of meetings there. Man came to me and told me how that he had been a Christian, walked closely with God, had known God blessing his life in all kinds of ways. And then he had gone away from God. And some years later, his cousin, who was a very, by all accounts, a very wonderful Christian, had been killed in a road accident. And this man had come to his cousin's funeral. And as one after another testified about his cousin's life and about the godliness of his life, he said, sitting there, I knew that I had gone away from God, I needed to come back. And I, at the end of that funeral, I gave my life back to Christ. And he said, that has now been several months. And during these last several months, I have asked God to give me back what I had 20 years ago, when I knew his presence in a very real way, in a very deep way. And I say, God, give me back what I had 20 years ago. And God isn't giving it me back. Why? And I said to him, I don't think God is interested in giving you back what you had 20 years ago. You can ask God to give you back what you had 20 years ago till the cows come home, and he won't be interested. Why don't you instead say, Lord Jesus, thank you so much for what happened 20 years ago, but today is a new day, and today your mercies are new every morning. Why don't you say to him, Lord Jesus, thank you for what you have for me today. Thank you for the freshness of your presence in my life today. Thank you for the blessing you have for me today. And tomorrow, pray the same thing. And the next day, pray the same thing. And discover his mercies are fresh and new every day. Because it's easy to try to recreate what God did in the past. God isn't interested in that. And so it's a very beautiful picture in that sense of Christ being fresh and new every morning. And that is what is right about this provision of manna. But what I really want to talk about this morning is what is wrong with this provision of manna. Because if this is a picture of Christ, as it is, because Jesus said it is a picture of a Christ who does not satisfy. You see, the manna did not satisfy the people. In Numbers chapter 11, after having lived on manna for some time, let me read you what it says. Numbers 11 verse 4. It says, the rabble with them began to crave other food. And again, the Israelites started wailing and said, if only we had meat to eat. We remember the fish we ate in Egypt at no cost. Also the cucumbers, melons, leeks, onions, and garlic. But now we've lost our appetite. We never see anything but this manna. The manna was like coriander seed and looked like resin. The people went around gathering it and then ground it in a handmill or crushed it in a mortar. They cooked it in a pot. They made it into cakes. It tasted like something made with olive oil. In other words, these people are getting sick and tired of the manna. It's manna for breakfast, manna for lunch, manna for supper, manna on Monday, manna on Tuesday, manna on Wednesday, manna on Thursday. Manna alive, they said, we're sick of it. Is this a very attractive picture of Christ? I mean, it's a picture of Christ, but a Christ who does not satisfy. I'll tell you this, there'll be some of you here this morning, and you're a Christian, and you know you're a Christian, but you have a Christ that is not satisfying to you. Do you know how you know? You're looking everywhere else all the time. Something isn't right. There's something wrong with this manna. But it's teaching us a very important truth, as these things all do. All of Scripture is given to instruct us in the things of God. So it's not just a history lesson here. There's some things here that teach us important truths about God. And I want to suggest to you what is contained here. I think we get a clue in the description of manna. In chapter 16 and verse 13, we read earlier, it says that that evening quail came and covered the camp. That's another matter. But in the morning, listen to this, there was a layer of dew around the camp, and when the dew was gone, thin flakes like frost on the ground appeared on the desert floor. Now, listen to this description. There was a layer of dew on the ground. When it was given in the morning, it was liquid, like dew, wet. And then it dried, and when it dried, it looked like frost. White. Like frost. But it was liquid when it was first given. Keep that in mind. That's a clue, and we'll come back to that in a moment. Another clue, chapter 16, verse 31. It says there, the people of Israel called the bread manna. It was white, like coriander seed. And it tasted like wafers made with honey. Now, here's some important detail. It was wet, and it was white, and it tasted of honey. We have to be careful here, but let me cautiously think this through with you. If you saw something on the floor that was wet, it's liquid, and it was white, what do you think it was? Especially if it was on your kitchen floor, and especially next to the fridge. And it was white and wet, you'd probably say somebody has spilled the milk. Its appearance. Although it doesn't use the word milk, the description is the appearance of it was like milk. And it tasted of honey. Where were they supposed to be going? A land, God said to Moses, Exodus chapter 3, verse 8, a land flowing with milk and honey. A journey designed to have been accomplished in 11 days. Says Deuteronomy. Now, when he starts to provide them with manna, it is 6 weeks into the journey. They've had plenty of time to catch up. Of course, 11 days is probably an uninterrupted, no breakdown, nothing going wrong. That sounds pretty speedy. But he's given them 6 weeks. And now he feeds them with something which is said Jesus, and therefore we must take this seriously, a picture of himself that looks like milk and tastes like honey, but frustrates them and causes them to grumble. There's another description of manna in Numbers chapter 11, verse 8. Let me read part of that to you. It says there that the manna, Numbers 11, 8, tasted like something made with olive oil. So it tasted of honey, but it tasted as though one of the key ingredients in it is olive oil. Now, those of you who know your Bibles reasonably well, and forgive me that there will be a lot of you for whom this is a new book, and you won't have picked this up yet, but those of you who know your Bibles fairly well will know there are many symbols that reoccur all the way through Scripture that are consistent in what they point to. And if I were to ask you, what is oil a symbol of? A lot of you would know. What is oil a symbol of in Scripture? The Holy Spirit. Again and again. The anointing of oil is an outward symbol of the anointing of the Holy Spirit in a person's life. For instance, when Samuel anointed Saul as king over Israel, it says he took the horn of oil. This is a reference in 1 Samuel 16. Anointed him in the presence of his brothers, and the Spirit of God came on him in power, because oil is a symbol of the Holy Spirit. Now, the manna then, all we know about the manna is, it was wet and it was white. When it dried, it looked like frost, so it was as white as frost. When it was wet, I suggest it looked like milk. It says explicitly it tasted like honey, and it says explicitly it was made with oil. At least it tasted as though it was made with oil. And I suggest to you that there in the manna are all the ingredients of God's full provision for his people, the milk and honey representing God's purpose, the land of Canaan to which he's taking them, the oil representing God's provision, the Holy Spirit, who would be the means of enabling them to enter and enjoy the land of Canaan. But although the manna contained the essential ingredients, it did not satisfy them. It just kept them alive. When I was in farming, when you decided what to feed the livestock, you first of all had what we called a maintenance ration, which would be just enough to keep the cattle or the sheep alive. And then you would add to the maintenance ration whatever you wanted to produce. If you wanted to produce milk, you added the kind of ingredient that would enable the cow to maximize his milk production. God is feeding them with here is the maintenance ration, just enough to keep them alive, but it didn't satisfy them. And you know, this is the true experience of a lot of Christians. If we were to sit down and talk very honestly, we might say to each other, are you a Christian? You might say yes. Have you come to the cross of Jesus Christ and confessed your sin and been forgiven of your sin? You might say yes. Have you received the gift of eternal life by the presence of Jesus Christ? In him is life, and you've received him, and therefore you have life? You'd say yes. If I were to then ask you, are you satisfied with Jesus? You might have to say no. And this is why I'm pursuing so many other things, in the hope that this will make life full for me, or this will give life meaning to me, and this will help me sleep at night with a sense of satisfaction. What is happening? When Paul wrote to the Ephesians in the New Testament, he explained to them certain things that happen when a person becomes a Christian. One of the things he says in Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 13, and I read from the middle of that verse, middle of verse 13 and verse 14, he says, having believed, you are marked in Christ with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession. Now he says, when you become a Christian, one of the things that happens is this, that God seals you with the Holy Spirit. That is, the Holy Spirit comes to indwell you, and you are sealed, that is, you are locked up, we might say, with the Holy Spirit within your life now. And he is a deposit guaranteeing your inheritance. Your guarantee of your inheritance has nothing to do with how well you behave. It has everything to do with the fact the Spirit of God lives in you and you've been sealed by the Holy Spirit. But Paul doesn't say, okay, if you got that, great, that's it. No, because if you follow through what Paul goes on to say to the Ephesians about the Holy Spirit, a couple of verses later, he says, I'm praying that God will give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation that you know Christ better. In other words, you've been sealed, but don't sit back now. You need to get to know Christ better, and the ministry of the Holy Spirit is revealing him to you that you get to know him better. He says in chapter 3, I pray that he will strengthen you with power through his Spirit. You not just know the presence of the Holy Spirit in your life, you know the power of the Holy Spirit in your life. He warns them in chapter 4, do not grieve the Holy Spirit with whom you were sealed. You've been sealed, but you can grieve him. That is, you can resist him, you can disobey him. And then in chapter 5, he gives them this command. In chapter 5, verse 18, do not get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery. Instead, be filled with the Spirit. So Paul says to those folks there, if you're a Christian, doesn't matter who you are, you've been sealed by the Holy Spirit. That is part of what makes you a Christian, the presence and sealing of the Holy Spirit in your life. But he says there's more to your relationship with the Holy Spirit than that. I want you to go on experiencing his revelation of Christ to you. I want you to go on experiencing his power at work within you. I want you to make sure you don't do things that grieve him. And here's the big one, I want you to live in the fullness. It's a present continuous tense, that sentence really. Be being filled, ongoing, being filled with the Holy Spirit. And I want to suggest to you this, that the manna is a picture of being sealed by the Holy Spirit. God is going to keep them alive. Sealed. But not being filled. In the book of Nehemiah, and chapter 9, it speaks there of the fact that during the years in the wilderness, God sustained them in the desert. That's the verse he uses, Nehemiah 9, verse 21. For 40 years, you sustained them in the desert. Now, sustained is kind of you kept them alive. But actually, in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 8, Moses talks about what happens when they do enter Canaan. And he says that when you get into Canaan and you have eaten and are satisfied, praise the Lord for the good land he has given you. In other words, there are two things that can happen to you in your Christian life. You can be sustained. How did God sustain them? He gave them manna every day, something which tasted the real thing. Looked like the real thing. He sustained them, but it was not the real thing. The real thing was the place where they're intended to be satisfied. In Canaan, where I'm going to satisfy you. And that's why it is stated a number of times through the journey that the Israelites were on for those 40 years, that the purpose in coming out was not simply to have come out, but to have come on and come in to the land of Canaan. That's what God said to Moses at the beginning, that his plan was to bring them up out of that land and into a good and a spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey. God reprimands them in Leviticus 25 and verse 38. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt. Why? To give you the land of Canaan and to be your God. In Deuteronomy 6, verse 23, Moses says there, but God brought us out from here to bring us in and give us the land that he promised to our forefathers. In other words, there's a repeated statement to the Israelites in these wilderness years that God brought you out, not to get you out, not just to get the slave drivers off your back, not just to give you the freedom of being liberated from slavery. That in itself is a wonderful thing, but God brought you out in order to bring you in to the land of Canaan, where you'll not only enjoy all the fullness of provision and be satisfied, but you'll be restored to the purpose which God called Abraham in the first place, which is that you become a blessing to the world. Now, you know, the reason why this is recorded for us, the book of Hebrews, if you look at it, chapter 3 and 4, says these things are recorded for us to keep us from failing to enter through unbelief as they did. Because God's purpose for you and for me is not just to bring us out of our sin, wonderful as that is, of course, but to bring us into that fullness of life with Christ, where He reigns in our lives, His Holy Spirit fills our lives, and we are equipped then not just to be satisfied, but to be a blessing to the world. But it's very, very possible, and very easy to be satisfied with the fact that, phew, I'm off the hook. Whew. If Christ were to come today, or I were to die tonight, I could give God the right answer as to why He should let me into His heaven. Phew, I'm satisfied. That is not the Christian life. It's part of it. You come out to come in. And what happens if you don't come in? Will He let you go? No, He'll sustain you. But He will not satisfy you. You see, unless we are prepared to go all the way with God, we will never be satisfied with Christ. And that is what the manna seems to me to be teaching. Unless you're prepared to go all the way with God, you'll never be satisfied with Christ. You're a Christian? Yes. You're an Israelite? Yes. You're out of Egypt? Yes. But what are you doing in the wilderness? Grumbling, mumbling, moaning, complaining. Because you're so dissatisfied. You cannot go back because you're sealed. Sealed by the Holy Spirit, as the Red Sea closed behind the Israelites when they came out of Egypt. And Paul, in 1 Corinthians 10, speaks about that as being baptized into Moses. It's a very interesting and beautiful picture of baptism. It's a picture of leaving your old master dead and buried behind you. Baptism is a picture of that. Dying to all of that, I'm out. But the purpose is, now I've come out, I can either go on and in and enjoy the fullness and be satisfied and be a blessing to the world, or I can stay in the wilderness and He'll sustain me. But He will not satisfy me. You're sealed with the Spirit, but you can grieve the Holy Spirit. You can quench the Holy Spirit, but every day there'll be the taste of honey on your lips and the taste of oil in your heart. There'll be a divine frustration, a divinely engineered frustration, a frustration given you by God in your soul, because this is not what He saved you for. Alan Redpath often gave his testimony. I heard it many times. How he was converted in his early 20s, came to know Christ, and soon afterwards he went away from God and back into his old life, began to do all the things he had done before he was converted, but as he said when he gave his story, there was one big difference. I used to enjoy all those things I used to do, but now, doing the same things, living the same way as I lived before, I didn't enjoy it anymore. I'd go home and I'd toss and turn in my bed at night. And it drove him to begin to seek for God, and he came back to Christ, and God greatly used him. He worked for a while with Operation Mobilization, which is an evangelistic movement reaching out all across the world. I know a man, after having spent that time with Operation Mobilization, and amongst other things, he studied some psychology and some philosophy, and he began to reinterpret his Christian experience in psychological and philosophical terms. And he turned his back on God, went right away from God. For a number of years now, he's been living in Australia, where he teaches in the linguistics department of one of the universities there. And some time ago, he was writing a doctoral thesis on the theme of religious dogmatism. And I go to Australia from time to time, and I usually try and spend a day or two with him. And I was talking to him when he was beginning work on this thesis, asking him what the objective was. And it was to explain away why people become religiously enthusiastic and dogmatic, and to explain it in psychological terms. And I said, why are you spending so many hours and probably years in study and research and investigation in order to be negative, to destroy something, to pull it down? Why don't you invest your time in doing something positive, be a lot more satisfying, surely? He said, I've asked that question myself. It's a good question. He said, I'm not sure. Maybe, and these were his words, maybe I'm trying to exorcise my past, to get rid of this ingrained stuff that I had in my growing years. The reason is because there was a day when he was born again of the Holy Spirit. He gave evidence of the fruit of that. And the Spirit of God sealed him that day. And what he's done now for many years is quench the Holy Spirit and grieve the Holy Spirit and lock the Holy Spirit up into a little corner of his life. But I tell you this, every morning my brother wakes up. The Holy Spirit in him says, good morning. I'm here. And he hates it. He hates it. And he will never be satisfied until he comes into Canaan. And my prayer is that one day he will. But I lived in the wilderness for a number of years after I first became a Christian. I believed it. I believed the gospel. I believed in Jesus. I was grateful for my forgiveness. I was grateful for the assurance of going to heaven when I died. And I wondered why it was so frustrating. Why do all the things that I find in my New Testament not seem to really work? And I concluded maybe the Christian life was like a carrot they used to dangle in front of a donkey's nose on a sort of fishing pole. The donkey would see the carrot. I like carrots, and I'll keep moving to get the carrot. And as you moved, you kept pulling the cart. And so that's how you got the donkey to go. And you never actually got the carrot. Maybe at the end of the journey, you give it to him. But maybe the Christian life is designed just keep me going because it's never going to work. And then I came to discover that Jesus Christ didn't just give himself for me. He gave himself to me. And he lived in me, and he would be the source of my life and my strength. You see, when they failed to go into Canaan in the book of Numbers, and the 10 of the 12 spies said, you know, that there's seven nations that live there, and some of them are wild. But they were numerically many more than the Israelites. There were giants amongst them, descendants of somebody called Anak. There were big people in there. And so much so, they said, we felt like grasshoppers in comparison with them. We cannot do this. That was their report back to Moses after 40 days of exploration. That was 10 of the 12. And the other two, Joshua and Caleb, said, everything you've said is right. But there's one thing you haven't said. If the Lord is pleased with us, he will give us this land. This is not our business. This is his business. Let's go into Canaan because God told us to, in dependence upon him, knowing that he is the one who's going to give us the land. And they were outvoted, and the Israelites stayed back in the wilderness for another 38 years. This was 2 years into their journey, 40 years, during which the entire generation of people over 20 who left Egypt died and were buried. 600,000 funerals of men in the wilderness years. Every one of them died except Joshua and Caleb. And when Joshua eventually led them in, they were just as strong and just as powerful and lived in the same fortified cities. But you remember the first fortified cities, Jericho, do what he says, walk around it, and God brought the walls down. God gave them victory. And all the way through the book of Joshua, you find God gave them the land. God gave them 28 times in the book of Joshua, it says, God gave them, God gave them, God gave them, God gave them. What happens when somebody gives you something? You reach out an empty hand. And the Christian life is not trying to live for God as best we can. Of course, there's discipline in the Christian life, but that discipline is not to get godliness into your life. It's so the life of God in us can live through an obedient person and body. And the manna was a symbol of the fact that God will never let you go. He made a covenant. He will not break it. There must have been days when Moses would go to bed at night and think, oh no, we've gone too far this time. The Israelites have rebelled yet again. They've disobeyed yet again. They've grumbled yet again. Surely God will leave us now. Yet if he got up at crack of dawn the next morning, went out, as the sun broke on the eastern sky and scanned the horizon, sure enough, there was a fresh supply of manna. Because as 2 Timothy 2:13 says, if we are faithless, he will remain faithful. He cannot disown himself. And if manna is a symbol of the fact that God will sustain us, he will never let us go, it's also a symbol of the fact he will never satisfy you outside of his will. He'll never satisfy us outside of going all the way with Jesus. There's only one solution to manna, and I finish with this. You find the solution in Joshua chapter 5 and verse 10. Let me read it to you. The Israelites now are in Canaan, in a place called Gilgal. It says, on the evening of the 14th day of the month, while camped at Gilgal on the plains of Jericho, the Israelites celebrated the Passover. The day after the Passover, that very day, they ate some of the produce of the land, unleavened bread and roasted grain. They're now enjoying this full provision of the land. Look at the next verse, verse 12. The manna stopped the day after they ate this food from the land. There was no longer any manna for the Israelites, but that year they ate of the produce of Canaan. That's Joshua chapter 5, verse 10 to 12. There's only one solution to the tediousness of the manna. And that is not finding new recipes for it. You know, I talk to people sometimes, and basically what they're saying is, you know, my Christian life is so frustrating. Do you have any new recipes you could give me? I've talked with youth leaders who say, how do we keep our young people? Do you know any good bands we could use? Do you know any good movies we could show them? Do you know any new recipes for the boring manna? Huh. That won't satisfy them. Only one thing will satisfy them. Take them into Canaan. Take them into the fullness of life that God has for us, where we live every day in submission to Jesus Christ as our Lord. We make it our business to get to know him better through his word and through the enabling and revelation of the Holy Spirit through the word. We surrender ourselves to the fullness of the Holy Spirit, not as an event, but as a day by day by day relationship with him. And we find that no matter what you're facing, no matter what situation you're in, no matter what hardships you face, there'll be a deep, deep satisfaction. You'll say with David, the Lord is my shepherd. And what's the result? There's nothing I want. I'm satisfied. Canaan was intended to satisfy them. And out of there, they would bless the world. There is no alternative but to go all the way with God. And I want to challenge you as I close this morning. Are you living not a life that is perfect? There is no such thing. But a life where your basic attitude is, Lord Jesus Christ, I surrender all that I am to you. And ask you by the Holy Spirit to fill me with yourself. And you get on with life and you discover that God not only satisfies you, but you find he makes you a blessing to the world. That's the outworking of it, as it was for the people of Israel.
Do you know someone who would benefit from this message? Share it through our website, livingtruth.ca. And while you're online, join the discussion about this week's message. and follow the links to our Facebook page and YouTube channel. Tune in next week for the continuation in this series from Charles Price.
Our God, say.